Hello, everyone. Welcome to another live-streamed Mix Tank Takeover by me. My name is Mark Abrams. I'm the Puremix content manager and mentor on these Mix Tank Takeovers. So today, if you've never seen one of these before, what we're going to be doing is reviewing mixes from the Puremix community, and I'm going to try and give some you know, helpful insight and comment on all the amazing mixes that are, I'm sure, are going to be on here. Every week, I'm completely amazed by a level of talent that's been submitted by the community. So this is going to be a blast. Before we get started, while we're waiting for some more people to join, I have a couple housekeeping things. If you want to participate in a Mix Tank Takeover, this is for Puremix Pro members. So you go to puremix.net, and if you're a subscriber, click on Mix Tank up in the menu bar. You can submit your mix there. We do this every Monday at 2:30 p.m. Eastern, and I hope to see your mixes on there. Also for the Pro members, I have some announcements for you guys. We currently have a mixing contest going on featuring Joe Ciccarelli with Alanis Morissette. Pretty cool. It's the song Guardian, and you guys can click on the contests in the menu bar and then go over to Joe's contest page, and you'll be mixing the song Guardian with the actual multi-tracks from Alanis Morissette for a chance to win some prizes from IK Multimedia, including Joe's new vocal strip plugin, as well as the Fame Studio Reverb and the Sunset Studio Reverb from IK Multimedia and some other goodies. So definitely check that out. Last week, we had a couple mix submissions on Mix Tank for Guardian, and you guys can feel free to do that. You know, as we kind of go into the end of the contest, we still have a couple weeks left, but as we do that, you can feel free to submit your mix here, and then we can talk about it on the air. And the pro members are also always available in the community to help give some insight and some things that you might want to check out before the final submission date. So yeah, definitely check out the mixing contest. Next Friday, we have a new video with Fab DuPont mixing a song called The Way I Feel Inside from Mr. Emotional. That track was produced by Angel Lopez, who also produced the latest Jack Harlow album, Come Home, The Kids Miss You. And the single from that record, First Class, has been in the top three on the Billboard Hot 100 for the last 13 weeks. So it's been going between one and two, and I think it's three this week. But Angel produced this song, and then Fab is mixing it in the video. So if you want to see how Angel thinks when he's producing songs like that, and you're a Jack Harlow fan or something, this is a good one to check out for sure. Also, if you dig hip-hop, this track's pretty cool. So that video comes out next Friday. That's going to be a lot of fun. I'm sure we're going to do a mixing contest with that at some point too, so keep an eye out for that. If you haven't already, make sure you like, hit the notification bell, do all the YouTube things. You know, I could be all yelly with funny voices now, so make sure you do that. That'll help us out a lot to keep stuff like this going. All right, so on my screen, we have Mix Tank. On the left, we've got submissions from all of the pro members. And over on the right, they put a little bit of info about that song. So they'll usually say, you know, for example, this one says, still producing, but wanted to submit a rough mix. Cheers. So he's in the beginning stages of this mix, and you can see where it says track status, it says early mix. So there's some info from the people about what's going on in the song, what they're looking for out of this. We'll be checking that out. And then in the center is where we're going to drop feedback. So I'll be leaving a comment that just says Mark was here with a little YouTube link, and you guys can go and check that out. One more thing while we're waiting for a couple more people to join. Last week I said we were going to do like a little bit of a discussion thing in the beginning of these, just for something for you guys to go check out while we're in between live streams. So we talked about bright and dark mixes last week between Ariana Grande's Break Up With Your Girlfriend and Billie Eilish Bad Guy. And Ariana Grande being like an example of a bright mix, Billie Eilish being an example of a dark mix. This week, I'm going to talk about a track from an artist that I'm insanely in love with named Sohn. And it's spelled kind of like John, but with an S instead of a J. So S-O-H-N. And the song is called Signal. I'm going to put a link in the chat for you guys to check it out. And a couple things I like about this track. The low end is fat. It's super fat. So that's a good reference point in low end. Like, it's fatter than a lot of things that are on the radio. So I kind of look at this one as like, it's probably up in the upper threshold of how much low end I go. You'll hear that kick drum in the beginning's pretty huge. And then the thing that I really use this track for is it has a super dry side stick sound on the 2 and 4, so for the snare. And I'll use this a lot if I'm going into a new room and I want to see just a good reference of how dry the control room is. So I'll put that track on and you'll hear how dry that thing is, and especially if you play it in headphones, if you're not in a treated room. But that track gives me a lot of information very fast. And I'll also use it if I'm doing like a front of house gig, like mixing live sound, and I want to hear how live the room is. I'll use this as a reference. I can also hear what's going on with the subs, if they're tuned well or if they're, you know, going to blow me out of the water or something like that. I'll know really fast because of that really fast kick drum, or that really fat kick drum. The other thing on this track is when it gets to the end of the song, the climax, there is so much going on. It's like insane. The energy is amazing on it. But one thing that happens with it is there's so much happening and everything's so loud that you can kind of hear the two bus compressor clamping down on things. And especially if you focus on that side stick signal, as all of the basses and the synths are going crazy, you'll hear it kind of like get clamped down, and it's not as present and in the same depth that it is in the beginning of the track. So I love it, and it was a creative decision. I think Manny Mariqueen mixed that track, so he doesn't usually make mistakes. So I'm pretty sure that that was all intentional. And the emotion that I get out of that when it gets to the chaotic part is there's like distortion across the mix and so much is happening that it feels like the chaos that I think Soam was going for when he was writing the track. So that's an example of how Manny drove everything so hard just to get the emotion of chaos going. And it's also a good lesson in, for me, that perfection isn't always the best. You know, if he had said, oh, I'm clamping the two bus and things are distorted and backed it off, it wouldn't have had the same emotion. So that's the track I wanted to talk about this week. Let's dive into some mixes. So how this will work is I have a draw a track button in the upper left. And when I hit that, I get some pretty sweet confetti. There it is. And we have a random track. So we're starting off with Chris.ru, his level is passionate. And this is the same one that we were talking about a second ago. So it's an early mix and still producing, but wanted to submit a rough. So let's check it out. Here we go.
Te enseñarán.
Okay. Awesome, Chris. Thanks for submitting that. Very cool. So definitely digging the vibe of that. And you wrote in here that it's a rough mix. So we'll take that into consideration as we're going here. I think the vibe's going really good. And since you're kind of in the middle of production, I think you're on the way to a really cool track. A couple things on the production front. I thought that the acoustics were rushing the groove a bit. You kind of have this like laid back groove happening with the percussion that feels awesome, but the acoustics aren't quite vibing with it, and they're pushing the beat a little bit. So I'm not sure that you necessarily need to retrack them. I think that you could maybe do a little bit of editing and not going like hit by hit or accent by accent and, you know, going super robot, but you might be able to listen and identify some parts that are pushing the beat a little bit and chop those up and then just slide the region back a little bit and see if things lay into the pocket a little bit more. This is something, even if it was at the end of the mix, I would still suggest that you do this. Some things that I think we forget sometimes is when we're making a mix, we're here to make the best sounding thing that we can. And sometimes people say, well, that's the producer's job. That's not really on me. And from my point of view, you're the mix engineer and you're trying to make the best mix that you can. If the groove's not working out, then, you know, who cares how good the mix is, right? So just anything that you hear like that, just address it. And you could duplicate the playlist or do a save as and even let the band or the producer know, like, hey, I did some editing on this. You know, if you don't dig it, we can go back to how it was. Just did some things that I thought would be cool for it. So I'd say, like, take a look at some of the timing stuff. And also with the acoustics right now, they're kind of the loudest thing in the mix, which really also makes that very apparent that they're pushing the beat in front of the drums and everything. So I would consider, like, how loud should other elements be? Should that lead vocal come forward a little bit? Being a rough mix, I totally understand where that would be at. You know, sometimes too, it could be like the guitars are the last thing that we tracked and they're really loud because that's what we were listening to. But yeah, I think like the lead vocal needs to be the star and come forward in front of those guitars a bit. And even at the end of the song, when you have more background vocals happening, some of those background vocalists are stepping out in front of the lead singer. So, this is common theme for me and I'm a little bit of a broken record with it from week to week, but the lead vocal is telling our story. It's the star of the show. It has to be in the center up front with the spotlight on it so we can hear what the song is about. We're here for great songs and not necessarily like the best sounding, you know, acoustic guitar or something like that. So just consider front to back, where are things and who is the star of the mix. That also applies to the end. You have a lead guitar line that feels like it's a little bit recessed and hidden to me, where it's trying to be heard and it's definitely the melody at that point. It's not really competing with the vocal or anything for the star space. It sort of is the moment. So just, again, making sure, like, when we get to that point, let that guitar player step forward on the stage and so that the audience knows, like, hey, he's the star right now. We're listening to his melody, and that's where my ear needs to go. Other than that, I mean, things are a little bit cloudy, 2 to 500. This, it sounds like a rough mix to me where, like, you know, not a lot of enhancement has been done or anything like that. So might not be at that stage yet, but that's, you know, first reaction is, like, it's a little cloudy. Things you can do with that, obviously you can try cutting 2 to 500, but I've been kind of turned on to trying to boost some things instead of doing cuts all the time. If you try to go above that range and maybe start boosting some higher mid stuff, you might also get the same effect and it might be a little bit more lively, especially if you're, you know, using something that's like modeling an old analog EQ or something. You might start getting some of the cool artifacts that does. So you know, just something for all of us to think about. Like, sometimes cutting isn't always the answer, and it's just that we need to find a frequency above it that speaks and then bring some attention to that, and the instrument might come alive a little bit. So, yeah, great job on this, and I hope that the rest of the production goes well. I think you're off to a great start. All right, let's draw a track. Confetti. Hold on. I'm checking things out. Okay, so Nat Jam, Level Pro. This track is an advanced mix. Simple meditative song idea that I played on guitar and recorded. I tried to keep things as simple as possible, focusing on the voice coming through, but still having the guitar strong and warm, but not too overpowering. I want to keep it big and warm, but not dull sounding. Dull and warm go together sometimes. All right, let's check this out. Here we go.
So sweet.
And it's so fun to go through these tracks. There's so much talent here. It's amazing. Great song. Great song. And yeah, I love everything that's going on in this. It's really cool. Really cool how you kept it simple and didn't go overboard on production and everything. I think it feels great. Shout out to Tom Foolery, who you'll see a lot on the Mix Tank boards, leaving comments and everything. He's Fab DuPont's assistant, and he's a beast. He's super awesome, and he leaves great comments all the time. I was reading through his while I was listening, and I agree with pretty much everything on here. So first off, calling attention to the vocal. I like where you place the vocal in this mix. It feels very big to me because of this buildup that Tom's talking about here in the 250 hertz area of it. There's some resonance, some low mid resonance that's happening in it, and things are just kind of bunching up and masking out some other stuff. It feels like that across the mix, but I think it could be dealt with instead of like strapping an EQ across your mix bus and dealing with it that way. I think you could deal with it on an individual instrument level, especially with this vocal, because that resonance in the low mids, whenever it peaks up, it's pushing into the reverb, and then I'm hearing it kind of like bloom out to the sides a little bit, especially when she hits that specific note that causes the resonance. And then that also applies to the guitar. I'm hearing that on the guitar quite a bit, where it's just kind of getting muddy. Our lead acoustic guitar that comes out on the right, it sounds like it was the same guitar, same mic position and all that, because they're very similar to each other. And on some of the harder picks, I hear a big bloom of low-end energy. So you could try just dipping some of that down with an EQ, or doing a high-pass filter and cutting out all the rumbly stuff, so we don't get like the big, you know, kind of like sub stuff coming from a lead acoustic instrument that doesn't really need it. You don't have to go super high. Just you know, try to scoop out a little bit of the bottom of that stuff. Or if you don't want to scoop it out with a high-pass filter, you could try just ducking some of it with a parametric or something. Very, very cool song. There was some S-ing on the vocal that got a little crazy, and I think that your ear might not have been drawn to it as much because of the blooming in the low mids. It gives the, you know, the tilt of that vocal. If this is the low end, it feels like it's, you know, kind of doing one of these. But when you clean up some of those resonances, I think that you're going to start hearing the peak stuff come through. So yeah, maybe like check out hitting that with the de-esser. You can also just look at your EQ curve and see what you're doing on the top and if you're just enhancing the S's or not. So, you know, don't want to make it unnatural, too much de-essing or anything. But yeah, I think you're off to a great start here. Great mix. Great song. All right, let's draw a track. Shout out to Great Fox in the chat room. Ah! All right. Sorry about that. I got scared. Shout out to Great Fox. You guys should check out the mix fix. It was a live stream with Fab DuPont where he mixed one of Great Fox's songs. It was a really, really fun episode. Cool. Just checking out the comments. Good to see everybody in here. What's up, Martin? Primetime Robots, Smoking Fudo. It's cool to see familiar faces in here every week too. Jeff Baggett, Francois. Good to see you guys. All right. Let's check out this track. This is a good roll from Dermy and Final Mix. So I'll read this while we're playing through. Here we go. Okay, so I'm actually going to hold off on this because I was here last week. And that reminds me that I forgot to drop my comment on the last one. So I'll do that now. Yeah, we listened to Dermy's track last week. So go check that out on the previous episode if you want to. And let's do another track. Here we go. All right. Cry Me a River. I don't recognize this one. All right. I haven't been here yet. This is from the Patapoof. I love that name. Cry Me a River. Here we go.
That they would come crashing down. You don't have to. say what you did. I already know. I found it from him. Now there's just no chance for you and me. There'll never be. Don't make yourself about it. You told me you love me. Why did you leave me all alone? Now you tell me you need me when you call me on the phone. Girl, I refuse. You must have me confused with some other guy. The bridges were burned. Now it's your turn to cry. Cry me a river. Cry me a river. Cry me a river. Cry me a river. You know that to say that something's a better left than said. It wasn't like you only talked to him and you know it.
Don't act like you don't know it.
All of the things people told me you're missing with my head. Should have become a stick, then you may not have blown it. You don't have to say what you did. I already know. I formed from him. No, there's just no chance for you and me. There'll never be. Don't make yourself about it. You told me you love me. Why did you leave me all alone? Now you tell me you need me when you call me on the phone. Girl, I refuse. You must have me confused with some other guy. The bridges were burned. Now it's your turn. Cry me a river. Cry me a river. Cry me a river. Cry me a
Nice. Cool. I'm wondering this noise at the end. It's like a ground thing. I'm hearing some stuff across the mix that feels, first off, great job. That's super cool. I love the song and Timberland's a beast. So yeah, anything like approaching a production of Timberland is, you got some guts. It's awesome. So yeah. Back to the noise thing. I'm hearing like the noise at the end. Normally I think that might just be part of it and you wanted it in there. It sounds like it might be from the guitar, but overall in the mix, there's like a phasing thing that's happening. And as some of the comments already pointed out, the snare is obviously on the left. That could be intentional. but I'm thinking it might not be because the kick feels a little off to the right to me, and then the whole thing feels a little bit smeared. So I'm kind of wondering what might be happening there. I think some of the other guys on the board commented that the snare is really bright, which makes everything else in relation feel pretty dull. I would agree with that. And I think that the snare, the excitement of the snare, could be your reference, the same way that you would use another mix as a reference track to say, like, oh, I like the shape of this, like the tonal shape of this mix, so I'll use that as a reference while I'm going through my mix. I think that snare can be your reference point for where the mid-range of this thing can live. And then making the other elements kind of match those tonal characteristics will really help everything kind of come alive. So the snare feels good to me. We just need to elevate the rest of the production up to kind of that same tonal shape, if that makes sense. Overall, it feels a little bit slow to me because I hear the vocal wanting to speed up a little bit. So it could be, you know, a couple BPM slow. It might be worth experimenting with that if this is all, you know, kind of MIDI stuff, or you can quickly do a test with like Elastic Audio or something. Try bumping it up a few BPM. And I get that you're going for like a laid back feel on it. So you don't want to kill that, but the vocal might, you'd probably want to re-sing it if you did this, but the vocal might sit better for you as a performer if it was a little bit faster. So one of the things I think Tom put in there was that you could go a little further with some of the effects on it. And I think that that's totally true. Like in the bridge, you have the high vocal sound with the reverb on it. But I'm feeling that that reverb could be more of a stereo thing. And you could do some tricks with sending the vocal to the back wall. So like if your vocal's here on the rest of the song, in the bridge where it's doing that high sung legato-y thing, you could push it to the back of the mix and then even play around with moving it around a little bit and having it just kind of be a sound that's kind of traversing across the stereo field there. There's some in the actual guitar sounds. Maybe play with whatever you're using for amp modeling on it, or if you're miking it or going direct or whatever, just play around with the guitar tones a little bit. I'm hearing some resonance on the guitar muted parts. And a track like this, the groove is everything, right? So we want it to be like really snappy and tight. And when the guitar mute, when that resonance bleeds over, it's extending the length of that note. So if you want it to be a tight palm mute and then your guitar goes whoom after that, it's like adding another quarter note onto whatever you were playing, or, you know, so it's like making it a half note instead of a quarter or something like that. So watch out for resonance, things like that. And it could be from having too much gain on the amp as well. So just, yeah, play with the tone and make sure that the tone is matching the part that you're trying to play and not changing the groove of it. That, you know, groove can be affected by compression. It can be affected by distortion, all of these things. And when you're going for the right guitar tone or the right tone on any instrument, you want to make sure that it's not messing up the groove of the part that you're playing. The playing sounds good to me. It's just the overall tone of it is making it want to last a little bit longer. The bass also had this characteristic to me, so it sounded a little bit loose performance-wise. The distortion was kind of messing with the groove of that as well. So just because it's so distorted, you try to play a tight bass part, but you can't because the guitar just wants to keep ringing and the distortion wants to keep ringing long after you've stopped playing the note. So yeah, just play around with those tones and try to tighten up the pocket a little bit. There's a lot of mouth noise on the vocal. This can happen with some like cheaper condenser mics too. I know you'll get like a lot more of the mouth noise stuff. Isotope D Mouth Click, I think is the name of the module. You can run that thing with the default settings and it won't mangle your audio and it takes care of all of that. It's amazing. I have like a quick macro setup to just run that on vocals. If I start hearing that stuff, I'll just select the whole file and run that thing and it'll get rid of all that junk. And again, without mangling the vocal, which is not easy to do. So that's pretty cool. The vocal ad-lib things that you have popping in here and there, I think that those could be wider and they could be closer to us too. So like when they happen, really making a moment, like you're schizophrenic and you hear it in the side of your ear. And then the only other thing is just the vocal tuning across the track. I just watch out for a little bit of that. If you happen to sing this again, a trick that I've mentioned before is take a piano sound and play the melody. Even if you're not a great piano player, you can play it super slow. Play the melody that you're gonna sing and sing it along with the piano. And you'll hear if you're out of pitch with it, and just go slower until you can match the pitch with it. And this is something I'll do a lot in sessions. If somebody's having a hard time with a part, I'll send them out to the live room, have them at the piano, tell them to play the melody with their hand a couple times, and then tell them to sing it and go super slow until the pitch gets into their memory. And then they'll walk back in the booth and knock it out. It's a pretty awesome trick. So check that out. And if you're in love with these performances, I would say just try to do a little bit of vocal tuning. You submitted a mix, so you're a Puremix Pro member, which means that you get access to Melodyne Essentials. So you could do some basic tuning with that, and it's free and a part of your Pro member account. So check that out. All right, let's go on to the next track. I see you left me a note here. Thanks so much. Yeah, you'll watch the video afterwards. That's awesome. I'll make sure I put the link in here. Let me grab my link. Awesome. And thanks so much for submitting too. All right, on to the next one. Here we go. Let's draw a track. Here's my reminder to smash the like button and the subscribe button and ring the bell and all those things. All right. Okay, this track is Guardian. Yeah, we did this one last week. I recognize your name, Glenn B., so I'm going to draw another track. Hope that's coming along well. We'll see if we get another one from that. And let me make sure I haven't heard this yet. I have not. All right, this one is from Joshua. The song is Keep Me in Mind Live. Started with this live mix recorded for a jazz band a few months ago. Some direction would be nice. Thanks. All right, here we go. Thanks, Smoking Fudo. I see you in there. That guitar sounds cool. It's almost like it's going through a Leslie or something. Glad you caught us, Adieu. Welcome. Okay, I'm gonna make a comment real quick. The way that things are kind of placed in this mix, right now I feel like I'm the drummer sitting at the throne and I'm looking at the guitar player on my left and the piano's kind of over here and then the crowd's out in front of me. So I'm just wanted to throw that in there and see if you guys hear that too while we go through the rest of it. Here we go. Cool. Gets cut off. So yeah, that was my biggest takeaway was I feel like I'm sitting at the drum set and I'm watching the rest of the band on stage, the crowd's out in front, and they're all jerks because they're talking the entire time. Listen to the music, people. it's kind of distracting. I think Tom commented on that as well. So it kind of bugs me. You know, we're trying to listen to some music and it's in a club that is, you know, maybe it's a restaurant or something. I don't know. But they didn't really interact with the band until the sax solo came. And because of the way that things are mic'd and presented and all that, I didn't get the sensation that this was even necessarily recorded live. It felt like it might have been a, can't think of the word for it right now, a walla track. There it is. Like you put in a track of some ambience happening at a restaurant or something. So since they're so distracting and talking and they're not really paying attention, I would say let's not pay attention to them either and let's make it more about the music. You don't have to kill them, like especially if you want people to know that this is a live track. You can have them up in the beginning like you do and then, you know, duck it out or whatever, but pull it back a little bit more during the performance and maybe push it when they react to the sax player and stuff like that. Just try to ride the audience a little bit more. The reverb that's going on, it feels very long, which doesn't really match the ambience level of the band to me. So I think that you're adding more onto it. The ambience that I hear on some of the instruments feels like a large auditorium or a gymnasium almost, in the way that it's kind of ringing out. But then the band feels a little bit tight, but with reverb on them as well. The audience feels that way. So I'd say like check out some of the reverb stuff and see if you can match it a little bit more to the space that you're in. I don't think that the audience needs more reverb necessarily, but there's some stuff in there that's going on. There's also some thumping. There's some sub stuff going on with the bass that's just causing a lot of like rumble underneath it. So Sonic Science Lab pointed out too that you could just high pass some of that, especially on the bass. I don't think it's the kick. He was wondering about that. It sounded like every time he was plucking a note, I was hearing some stuff really on the bottom. I would agree with Sonic's comment about the presence in the cymbals. It gave this perception like they were the brightest thing over top of the rest of the band, and it called attention to them like they were the most important thing. Same thing with the drums, how we were feeling like we were sitting at the drum set and watching the rest of the band. It would be good to take some of the focus off the drums, place them back a little bit. Unless you're going for that because you totally nailed that. Like that feels like I'm at the kit, which is, it's pretty cool. Like once I kind of got that picture in my head, I was like sort of seeing the mix in a different way, and it's totally valid. So kudos if you were going for that, because that'd be really hard to do. That's cool. I'd say like just check out who the most important thing is. Like when the snare hits and the toms hit, they're much louder than like the guitar and the rest of the band and those instruments happening. And anytime that something is the loudest, it's telling me it's the most important and I should be listening to it. So I just kind of, as you're doing a mix pass, think about who's the spotlight on right now, who are we listening to, and direct the listener in that way. So overall, it's super cool, and the players are awesome, and it sounds like everything's recorded really well. I just take another look at like who's the feature and all of that kind of stuff. So great job, Joshua. I think it's like it's on the way to being really cool. You have some really great tones going on in the mix too. It's just a matter of like placement and all that thing, and that's again all personal taste. So if you're, you know, totally digging what you got here, keep going. All right. Let's go on to the next here. Draw a track. Let me see how you guys are doing in the chat. I don't know if anybody saw the first mix tank, but I was muted for like the first 10 minutes and I was just talking. Now I'm paranoid every time I talk that the microphone's going to be muted and I'm just going on and on to my camera. Okay. This is Guardian. Let me make sure I didn't hit it. Oh, I forgot to leave my note on the last one. Drop that. Boom. Okay. Next song. Guardian. Okay. I haven't been here yet. So this is the song from the mixing contest. Let's check it out. We'll be right back.
So why would you talk to me at all? Such words were dishonorable and in vain. Their promises solid as a fog. Where was your
Awesome. Man, that's a good song. Okay. Yeah, great job. This is from V. Bacalo. Sorry, I'm butchering the name. But yeah, very cool. This is from the ones that I've heard on here. I feel like you got the levels and the important moments. You've kind of nailed them the best so far of the ones that I've heard on Mixtank and these takeovers. I feel like you're featuring the right instruments at the right time. I love the level of the vocal and the how forward it is in the mix on the verses. I feel like it's like right there where it needs to be, and it's telling me like this is Alanis Morissette, which is super cool. I love the spread that you have going on the "Where Was Your Watchman Then?" I think is the line leading into the chorus. That's really cool. Everything feels great on there. Overall, I feel like there's a lot of stereo spreading going on with this. It feels phasey and like it's happening 4 feet out of my speakers a little bit. So I'd watch out for some of that. And if you are listening, if you're listening on speakers and you feel like you need to do that, it's possible that your speakers are too close and you're wanting to hear everything wider. So just take a look at where your monitor placement is and listen to some of your favorite songs. Listen to the width of those songs and where do they exist in the stereo field, and then listen back to your track and see if you spread it out further than everything that you're listening to. On headphones, it's pretty easy to overcook that kind of stuff too, so just watch out for that if you're on headphones. The EQ overall feels a little overcooked on individual elements and the entire mix. Just it feels like things are being kind of carved out a lot and boosted in kind of an unnatural way on other things. So I maybe take a look at some of that stuff and just seeing if you're overcooking it a little bit. We want the instruments to sound natural. You never want the producer, you know, if you're sending this back to Joe Ciccarelli and he's the producer on this, you're sending him this mix back. You don't want him to instantly be like, well, that's not how we tracked it. This doesn't sound right. You don't want to go overboard and like, you know, scare everybody when they get it back into thinking like, what happened? We didn't track it this way. Things aren't like unsalvageable with that stuff either. So, you know, I don't mean it to be too extreme, but this would probably shock somebody if they got it back after sending it. I'd also like watch out for the reverb sounds on things. Make sure that they're not messing with the groove. It feels a little bit swimmy to me right now too. The vocal felt like it had a little too much de-essing going on that was taking away some of the natural stuff in that. So yeah, I mean, stereo bus compression might be a little hard too. So just check out how some of those things are feeling. Keep working on the balances of like the drums and everything. Make sure you're getting enough power in those choruses and all that. But yeah, I feel like it's on its way to being really cool. And I hope to hear another mix from you next week from it. If you end up attacking it again and doing another pass. Cool. All right. Let me drop my comments. There we go. All right, so I think we're going to go until about 4 o'clock today, so it's 3:30. Let's try and get a couple more tracks in. I might bounce around a little bit to try and sneak in a couple more tracks here. All right, Glenn B., we already saw yours. Let's keep going. See You in the Light, Tim Thompson. Okay. Looking for a well-balanced, competitive mix that is pleasing at any volume. I'm going to check it at all the volumes. Okay, here we go from the top. Man, I love that bass tone. Waking up early at the crack of dawn. Working like a dog, just trying to get that bone. Baker man called, said he's coming to take the land. You know I'd like to give him the back of my. Okay, I'm gonna go forward a little bit here, just to hear what's happening at the end of the tune. Man, I love this song, Tim. That's very, very cool. This feels great. I love the vocal melody, the arrangement, the words are cool. This whole thing is awesome. Very cool. I think a lot of the mix stuff we could talk about is actually pretty well displayed at the end of the track here. So let me just play a little bit of the end of this. Man, that bass sounds like an amazing P bass or something, too. Listen to the acoustic guitar at the end here. So very bright and present, right? Back here, if we're listening through the loud section, everything feels pretty muffled and not as bright and articulate as that acoustic guitar does to me. And that's kind of distracting. So this is the kind of thing where in a tracking session, you might have been going for the best sounding acoustic guitar that you could find. And that does sound really good. But then not looking at how it relates to the rest of the mix. So everybody else feels kind of like muffled and dark and diffuse to me, while that acoustic guitar is telling me again, like it's the most important thing in the mix because it's got the most presence, the most volume in the verses and stuff too. It's the most forward element. And I've talked about this on other takeovers, but if you imagine a stage and if you're thinking about like how you lay a band out on the stage, you got the lead singer. He's usually like a couple feet in front of the guitar players because everybody's trying to connect with that guy. And they're like chilling until it's their moment to shine and they come forward. In this one, it'd be as though like the acoustic guitar player walked out in front of the singer and just played the rhythm guitar while the guy's like singing behind him. And like Tool does that, I guess. And it's pretty cool. But if you can imagine like with this song, if he wasn't like standing off to the side, but it's panned up the center. So he's literally like walking in front of him, just being like, I'm the best. This is me. It's about me. So maybe ask that guy to come back a little bit on the stage and let the singer stand forward. Now, on this type of track, I don't think it'd be super cool if the singer was right in my face. This has like a very vibey, flowy feel to it. And it's got a little bit of like a genre thing going on too, where you don't want, it's not the Alanis Morissette song where we need Alanis to be the superstar. He could be behind the snare a little bit, but the snare needs to kind of brighten up to be able to come forward a little bit. Some of that low mid stuff needs to be, you know, just taking some of the clouds away on it. And we still want the vocal to be important, but it doesn't necessarily have to be the thing in front of the mix. Not that you want the snare drum to be out in front of the singer either, but you could kind of use that as a pinpoint to decide where the vocal is. You can recess them a little bit with like some reverb and stuff like that. I've pointed this out before too. Foo Fighters is a great example of this. A lot of times the snare drum is right in front of Dave's voice and it feels like he's trying to scream to get over it. And it builds this like really cool energy in rock tracks. That's really exciting. So I think you've got a lot of great stuff going on here. I want to know what you used on that bass. So you should like comment back to me or something on here. And let me know. But this is awesome. I think the production's great and you have a lot of cool things going on. I love the synth sound that was in there. Very cool track. Let's draw another one. Here we go. Okay, this is called At That Time version 2.0 from user 12410807 29. Whose level is passionate? I'm gonna do that every week. He submits mixes every week and it's awesome. Thank you for submitting another one. I just love your username. Here we go. Oh, I forgot. I was holding up my decibel meter. I did that because the last track said that they wanted it to sound good at all volumes. Part of that is making sure that the mid-range is right. Right now, I feel like things are really kind of dull in that last track, and which you might have been mixing loud, and it felt comfortable to be that loud. Like when I was at 85, yeah, it's pretty loud, but it didn't feel harsh to me. I was still comfortable at that volume. But I needed to feel good at low volume too. And overall it felt a little bit like it was missing some detail stuff. So don't worry about the volume thing too much. If you get the mid range right, it's going to feel great everywhere and, at whatever level. So just watch out for peaky things if you're hearing them, but you can deal with those on an individual basis. And, the thing we're going to talk about before next week's stream is dealing with, a temporary problem with the permanent solution. That'll be like our little intro thing that we talk about. And I think that if you're thinking about the volume thing and making everything dull, you're dealing with what might be temporary problems, like little screeches in the vocal or guitars or something like that. You're dealing with it on a global level and might be overthinking a little bit. So yeah, don't worry about it. All right. Sorry, I interrupted you, user 12410807 29. Here we go.
那时候的你 善良而美丽。那时候的我依然很年轻，那时候的我们天真的爱情，那时候的他们一样的妒忌。那时候你常陪我看天上的星星，那时候我也常想这样唱歌给你听。那时候的天空也没有这么多乌云，那时候的路上也没有现在的拥挤。那时候我曾把爱情当作游戏，直到最后遇见你，我才明白我的心。那时候为你写。
Okay, cool. I'm gonna go forward a little bit so we can hit a couple more tracks before we sign off here.
雨的时候，那时候我也曾把爱情当作游戏，直到最后遇见你，我才明白我的心。那时候为你写的信还来不及给你。我只想给你听，那时候我也曾把爱情当作游戏，直到最后遇见你，我才明白我的心。那时候为你写的信还来不及给你。
Cool.
过去，我把故事留给曾经留给。
Awesome. Yeah, very cool. I like the kids at the end there. Nice job. This is feeling really good. And I don't remember specifically if we hit this one on a previous stream, but I think it's sounding really cool. And the one of the things I like a lot is where the vocal's sitting out front. That feels like it's balanced really nice. The drums and some of the other individual instruments are feeling a little muffled to me versus some of the other stuff. So you can hear it quite a bit on this drum fill.
那时候我也曾把爱情当作游戏，直到最后遇见你。
Okay, so here it comes.
我明白我的心。那时候
So I just kind of hear like a rumble on there, and there's some stick in there, like you hear some of the stick hit, but overall, like the attack of the drum hits doesn't really feel like it's cutting through the mix. I just kind of hear whoop, whoop, where I'm hearing like a pretty present, I think it was like the acoustic and the vocal and everything. It doesn't quite match the tone of the other instruments. In our louder section with the kick and the snare, the kick feels louder to me and like it's, again, more important. The snare feels a bit muffled, especially in comparison to the vocal. So in this is something like on a couple mixes now we've heard. So like overall thought would be when you're choosing the tones for the individual instruments of the mix, figure out who's the most important, who's the star of the show, right? If it's the lead vocal, you've got the tone of her vocal. If you want other things to live on the same plane, or in the same band as that lead vocal, they need to kind of match tonally, right? Like you want everybody to have the same kind of feel, like they're in the same space or they have the same sort of attention to detail in each of the sounds, right? So use one of those sounds for the reference. And then as you're dialing in other sounds like the snare or the kick or whatever, keep listening to the relation between those instruments and seeing like, does this sound like it is in the same song or the same record? The same way that you would think about mastering a record. If one song is super, super bright and the next song is super dark and then you have another one that's all mid-range, they don't feel like a cohesive body of work. And it's the same when we're on this more microscopic level of a mix where we want the elements to feel like they're, you know, kind of living in the same sonic playground on the same canvas and not completely separated. So in this one, I would say like, the vocal feels pretty good. What if you use that as the reference point for how detailed everybody else should be in the mix? And then, yeah, just watch out for the low end on the kick drum. It felt like it was blooming and a lot bigger than the rest of the song. Kick drum's not the star usually. The vocal is up there. So yeah, just something to think about. And I think you're on the way to a great mix. Good job. Thanks for submitting that. User 12410809. All right, I'll see you. Next song is A Good Roll. I was here already. Let's hit one more. Okay, no feedback yet. So this is Goodnight Train by Eli Woolmeyer and his band, City to City cover, revision 2. All right, I'll be reading these comments over here as we go. Here we go. Oh, this is Smoking Fudo. I see you in the chat. Here we go. Had to get the bass slide at the end. That's awesome. Smoking, this track is awesome. I love it. Very cool. Thanks for submitting it. Yeah, people digging it in the chat too. Very cool. Okay. So yeah, a couple things that you pointed out in your notes on it. So you tried to comp- unpack the low end a little bit. You're trying to figure out how to remove some of the highs in the vocal, especially in the vocal effects. Keeping those that I like. So I tried to give a more natural sounding snare, but keeping the oversaturated effect that reminds me a bit of 70s vibes. So I think that you're nailing the 70s thing, especially with that snare and stuff. And I think that feels really cool. This isn't a thing where I'd say like brighten things up or anything like that. The vocal, the high stuff in the vocal, let's talk about that, especially in the vocal effects. So to me, it sounds like there's a reverb that is just reacting to the top end of some of the instruments, and not just the vocal, but I also hear it in the ride cymbal when he's kind of riding on. I hear like in my room and this, you know, stuff, and I had bacon for breakfast and all that. The ride feels like it's here, and then the reverb sounds like it's a little bit higher. Like it's almost like there's a top, like a high shelf on the reverb that's boosting it up a little bit. And I think like, whatever the reverb is that's going on, if you play with the high pass filter on that and just cut out some of the top on it, you could clean up a lot of that. And when you do, it's going to add a lot of definition to the notes that are being played, especially with the ride. I think the whole groove is going to tighten up, because kind of like the other thing where I was talking about resonances extending the note value, reverb is doing that too, and it's messing with the groove of your song. Your drummer's trying to play, you know, 16th notes on his ride or whatever, or 8th notes on his ride, and those are being extended out into like almost whole notes because the reverb tail is so long and there's so much high frequency decay on that, that it's just kind of clouding up the groove where the band's really, really tight. If you bring some of that stuff back, it's going to bring everything kind of back into focus instead of a little bit of the smearing that's happening across that. Same thing with the vocal. The syllables and the words are being extended. And if you imagine like taking a hip hop vocal, right, like a rap vocal, and adding reverb on top of that, you're going to completely mess with the flow of it because they're doing like a fast syncopated, you know, beat. Maybe they're doing like 8th notes or something like that, and you're extending out all those words. It's just going to get kind of muddled and confusing. That's kind of what's happening here, but it's just happening with a really bright reverb. So I would say like maybe try to bring down the play around with like a couple different things. Do a save as. One, try doing like a plate, like a darker sounding reverb, and then keeping a shorter delay time because this is a very fast up tempo song. We don't want things like bleeding over each other and causing a lot of like muddled mess. So yeah, just be respectful of the groove and try to bring some of the articulation that's going on out. In the vocal feels like the brightest thing to me. There was some peak stuff, 2 to 5K, that was kind of jumping out once in a while. I would just play around with your EQ and see what's going on there. If you've boosted a lot of stuff, or if it just came in like this and it's a really bright sounding vocal, you could try to do some inverse stuff. Sometimes like I like to do the pull tech with this, like just taking some of the stuff and instead of like worrying about the boost, just using the cuts on it and seeing if you can shape it a little bit that way. The you know, tape plugins are really good for this kind of stuff, especially like the Studer, where you can kind of tweak the top end of the machine, and it's almost like an EQ curve, right? Like not even necessarily thinking of it as a tape machine, but you're just affecting the top end of it with how you're calibrating the machine and all that. So yeah, I'd say check some stuff like that out. Any kind of pull tech style EQ thing, or just play around with the stock EQ that you have and just see what happens. Even if you do a low pass filter and take off some of the very top, you might add a little bit more of that 70s vibe to the vocal too. The only other thing that like kind of really jumped out at me was the kick drum doesn't feel like it's style appropriate. So you like the oversaturated kind of thing that's going on with the snare, which I think you nailed. The kick feels like it's a little bit more of a scooped rock sounding kick to me instead of like a more mid-rangey, punchy 70s sounding kick. So I just take a look at like the low end of that and like how the EQ curve is and all that and the tone of that drum and see if you can bring it into the same drum kit that the snare is in. Yeah, overall, it sounded really cool though. And I think you're on the way, man. This is super cool. Thanks for joining today and hanging out with us. Very cool to have you. Okay. Yeah, Mix in the Cloud says, try different flavors of compression for the more brittle sounds. Yeah, absolutely. Very cool. Yeah, see if you can smooth some stuff out. That could work on the vocal, too. He's got a great point there. So, all right, next track. Here we go. Here's my mandatory reminder to like and subscribe and comment and all those things. Okay. See you in the light. We just hit this one. Draw another check. And this one we hit earlier, but I forgot to drop my comment. So there it is. And let's draw another check. Horsetooth, we have to listen to this. That's a great name. And I like this picture. Awesome. Okay. Who is the Metro? And the song is called Horsetooth. Let's check it out. Here we go. Sorry, I want to go back and talk about this. There's something happening here that's causing some phase stuff, and it's making it like wrap around my head in a weird way. Let's listen. Yeah, I don't know if it's completely out of phase. If it's the organ, I think it's doing that. But on those hits, it sounds completely out, and it's wrapping around my head weird. And I'm pretty sure if I sum the mono right now, it would just disappear. So watch out with any stereo widening stuff that you're doing. And if you're not doing any of that, just check the polarity between the left and the right on, I think it's the organ. So here we go. So there's something, the reason I'm bouncing around here, I wanted to see if that same room sound was as present on the first verse section as it is here. So listening one more time. So something feels really clogged here, almost like there's a phase issue going on in the overheads or something. They feel really wide to me, but they also feel very muddy and like there's some comb filtering going on. So might be worth checking polarity on your overhead mics. And the room sound, I think that there's a room being added to it that sounds like it's up really, really high, and it's making it feel unnatural and like they're in a different space than the rest of the instruments in the track. And just a general note, it's important to make sure, like, you kind of heard a few examples of this today where it sounds like a lot of time was spent making the instrument sound really good. In this case, the drum kit as a whole, that like the room sound had a lot of thought put into it and all those things. But then when you bring in the other instruments to the picture, they don't feel like they were approached with the same intention or the same shape as the same tonal shape as the other elements of the mix. So it makes things feel really disconnected and like they're part of, you know, a part of different bands or like a part of like one session. This one has the vibe for me where like the drums were recorded in the 80s in a different studio, and then this stuff was being overdubbed on top of it in like a bedroom or a more modern studio or something like that. So they don't feel like a part of the same song or the same recording to me. So yeah, just like work in context, like make things sound amazing. If you know, there's different approaches. Some people never solo when they work on stuff and they only work in the context of the other elements of the mix. Some people always solo. And if you do that, just make sure that the rest of the record feels good around it when you bring the faders up and they're part of the same song and the same recording and all that. So let's go on a little bit further. I love that arpeggiated synth right there. That's a super cool track, man. Very nice job. You can hear some of the phasey thing that I was talking about with the overheads on the side stick here. So let's listen to this last section again. Plus, I just want to hear that synth again. So with the side stick, I kind of want to hear like a pinpointed side stick, right? Even if it's not close and tight and close mic'd, I want to hear that it has a specific location in the stereo field. And with whatever's happening with the overheads and stereo widening and all that stuff, I feel like the side stick takes up like a foot of the stereo field instead of feeling like it's a nice tight picture of the side stick that's happening. So just a thought there. I'll play it one more time. Yeah, I love that track. That's super cool. Great job. Yeah, hopefully that stuff helps, and if you do another pass, definitely put it up here. I'd love to hear it again. Very cool. Cool track. Keep going with it. All right, guys. I think that that's going to do it for today. Thank you so much to everybody that submitted. I hope that's been useful. Again, please do all the YouTube likey subscribe stuff. And that helps us keep going. There's the mix contest going on right now. Joe Ciccarelli featuring Alanis Morissette. You guys can win some plugins from IK Multimedia on puremix.net. Go check those out, and you guys can submit your mixes for next week. I'll be back here 2:30 p.m. Eastern. Head over to puremix.net, click on Mix Tank, and you can submit a mix if you're a pro member. So, yeah, again, thanks everybody for joining. Thanks, Great Fox. Thanks, I see Primetime Robots, Martin Gravel. Thanks for joining Mix in the Cloud, Smoking Fudo, and I hope to see you guys again next week. Thanks to the guys who have been showing up every week, too. It's been awesome. So, see you.